Midnight. We've got something great going on for you on After Midnight. 1, 2, 3, After Midnight, the champagne of evening television.
Hi, welcome to After Midnight. I'm your new host, Nick McGuire. Now, I'm hoping to hold on to this job, so would you please call the station, write in, do anything, you know, post about me on Facebook, just say, wow, I think that Nick is pretty swell. Or don't, I mean, I don't know, I mean, look, give me a few episodes to do this, okay, please. Steve.
On the road.
Over here. You've been on the road again.
I've been on the road.
All right. Where have you been?
Well, it's a local road this time.
Okay.
Sometimes we'll do an international road, but given these days, our viewers sometimes like to take a trip themselves.
Okay.
And this one's just across the bay. It's Chestertown and St. Michael's.
Okay.
Both great little Eastern Shore towns. If they haven't been there, they should go because it's a great on-the-road type trip.
Now, how far away is that from Baltimore Center?
Well, I'm going to guess it's roughly, say, about an hour and a half,
hour
and three quarters to get either one to St. Michael's. You go south on Highway 15. You go north on the trail.
Right. Okay.
Got to go across the bridge.
Okay, so it's not going to hurt you too bad on the gas.
That's right.
Gonna get there.
You know, tourist friendly, man. I'm talking about a place that you only have to spend money between 9 and 5, but they shut the place down at 5.
Yeah.
Well, they do. You'll be back home in time for dinner. So it's
lovely.
Well, taking the family for the weekend or whatnot?
They have some great little B&Bs, both in Chestertown and in St. Michael's. If you Google either one of those will come up. And they got some budget hotels as well, so it's a great place for them.
See, when I think of B&Bs, I don't think of families. You know, I think of romantic getaway, something like that. So, it sounds
well,
like
you know, this
really
is
great
after
place,
midnight.
You know,
and talk about some of those romantic types of things.
Well,
so.
Let's tell you what. I think we got a clip here. Why don't we tell us what we're going to be doing.
You're going to like this clip. Let's take a look.
All right.
I'm Steve Isaiah. We're at the Chestertown Farmers Market and Fair. We're going to see a lot of fun things. We have some produce coming up, some flowers, we have some crafts. It's all here at Chestertown. This fair starts in April. It's every Saturday, and it runs all the way through Christmas. So if you want to do a nice day trip, Chestertown's on the Eastern Shore. It's only about an hour's drive away from Baltimore. Let's take a look and see what's inside. On the wharf on the Chester River. Behind me you see a by boat. A little bit to my left, your right, is what's called a skipjack. And behind us is the Sultana. We're going to be going on the Sultana in just a moment. We're going to interview the president and captain of the Sultana. It's a very interesting story, so please stay with us. We're on board the Sultana. We're here with Drew McMillan. He's president of the Sultana Foundation, if I'm using that term correctly. And first thing our viewers probably want to know is, tell us about the original Sultana.
The original Sultana was a merchant ship. It was built up in Boston in 1768, and it was pretty small. And right after it was built, it was bought by the Royal Navy to enforce the tea taxes. And that's why it's such a special boat, because when the Royal Navy got a hold of it, they kept meticulous records. So between 1768 and 1772, we know everything the boat did every day, the name and birthplace of every person who was on it. And it's a great window, it's a great snapshot on American history in the years leading right up to the Revolution.
Well, that's fascinating. So tell us about the current Sultana, its history, how it got started.
Yeah. The new Sultana was the idea of shipwright John Swain. And back in the mid-90s, he had the idea that it would be a great thing for a small colonial town like Chestertown, that was a historic port. This town was founded as a port. To have some vestige of that history on the waterfront. So in other words, to build the type of ship that used to come to Chestertown. And because there were so few examples of that type of ship, Sultana was one of about seven or eight boats of the right size that there was any real information about. So that's how it started. It became, really it started rolling in about 1997 and it moved very quickly. It was very well received by the town. And believe it or not, by 1998 we were building. And by 2001 it was launched.
Crew, thank you so much for your time on board the Sultana, and we look forward to a cruise later this spring.
Thank you. You're welcome back anytime to go sailing, as is anyone who's watching this. You should come sailing, too.
They certainly should.
That was interesting.
It was, you know, then that kind of thing, you'll see if you take a day trip over there.
I can't wait to go.
Yeah. Well, it's pretty exciting.
Well, I just want to, you know, cut the show now. Let's just go.
Yeah. Well, no, we don't have to get you to our viewers to do the whole...
Well, yeah, that's right. 9 to 5. Yeah.
And I'll roll it up again until 9
in the morning.
Sean hasn't had a chance to do his magic. Can I say that in quotes?
Oh, yeah, man. I've been doing magic at the gas station, man. Yeah.
Okay.
What
are
you driving? I'm bringing down the gas price. What I'm doing, open up my wallet, man.
Yeah.
And what I see is my money. And of course, when I get ready to leave the gas station, suddenly... I find out what happened.
I mean, John, the next time, don't spray gas on your wall, and that's not gonna happen.
Did you tell me your vest was made out of asbestos?
I'll tell you what, guys.
That's creepy. Okay, listen, we're gonna take another break here, gentlemen.
All right.
And we're gonna have our next guest on when we come right back.
Okay.
Right.
Yes,
we do.
Yes, we do.
Imagine that. All right, be right back.
After midnight.
You list my credits, and I realize in listening to that to a profound extent, I consider myself the great American comics journeyman.
Okay.
Because unlike a lot of my colleagues who are committed to doing this sort of book or that sort of book, one guy's a Western guy, one guy's a war guy, I feel I can provide work of that quality, of a certain quality, on any kind of genre I'm confronted with.
Right.
Which makes me an odd bridging link to the previous generation.
Because
the guys who I read growing up were guys who could do anything. They did westerns, they did war, they did romance, they did science fiction, superheroes. But the only thing I can't feel comfortable doing is teenage comedy and funny animal stuff, because I just suck at it.
Right.
When I started writing my own stuff, was that there was a niche that had not really been filled in comics.
Right.
And that I felt comfortable trying to find a way to evolve an effective anti-hero in comics. There really hadn't ever been, which is an odd thing when you think about it.
Yeah, there really hadn't.
Because it exists across the board in fiction of all sorts, in film.
All right, hey, welcome back after midnight. All right, now we have our first guest, gentleman here. He's Ulysses E. Campbell from the Fantastic Forum comic book show. So, gentlemen, why don't you move down one, make some room?
Shift!
Now, here we go, shift!
You guys
shift.
Here all the time, make room for the guests. All right.
Hey!
Good to see you. Good to see you.
Thank you.
All right.
Welcome aboard.
Thank you. It's a pleasure.
I'm glad to know that it's Ulysses E. Campbell as opposed to Ulysses F. Campbell.
That's no good.
We got to distinguish between the other Ulysses Campbell, who's Ulysses B. Campbell, who's my son.
No.
And right. Ulysses Campbell, who's my father. But you wouldn't mistake me for him because he's been dead for about 30 years.
This is. And the show's going to be dead if we don't move on.
Fantastic Four. Why don't you tell us a bit about the show?
I would love to tell you about Fantastic Four. It's a little comic book show that I've been producing for about 5 years. It airs on six different stations in the D.C. and Maryland area, Virginia also. Labor of love, really. It's a segmented program on comics, science fiction, fantasy, and their related multimedia. It's primarily a discussion show. We bookend the discussion with different segments. I do an interview with some sort of comic book related artist, editor, writer. We have parodies that we do, event coverage, features, basically whatever sort of pops into mind that I think will be interesting and engaging that I can get people to watch. And it has been a lot of fun to do. I've got some wonderful people working with me on the show, and I'm getting ready to start the fourth season.
Really? Four seasons.
You should be in your heyday with the Avengers movie and the emphasis on the Batman Returns.
Well, you know what? Actually, it's funny you mentioned that. We got a clip coming up here from the show. Okay. And just check it out. We'll be right back with you, Lizzie, too.
When ABC TV approached renowned auto customizer George Barris to create a Batmobile for their new series, he had only a matter of weeks until filming began. With inadequate time available to design the car from scratch, Barris decided that the 1955 Lincoln Futura concept car would be ideal for use as the base vehicle for the Batmobile. Barris contracted Bill Cushenberry to perform the work, which was completed in only 3 weeks. Acquired by Barris for $1, the cost to modify the Futura concept car was $30,000. The approximate value of the Batmobile in 1966 was $125,000. This original Batmobile One is today valued at $2 million. During the run of the TV series, Barris refurbished the original and constructed several duplicate vehicles.
This is how it all begins, with a fiberglass car body that we mount to a 1970s Lincoln Town Car. The fiberglass car body comes out of a 22-piece mold, and we assemble the entire body here at the shop. And the car body comes out of the mold as a one-piece body, so there's nothing grafted together. And then we have a separate hood, doors, and trunk lid, and it provides a lot more strength to a car body to do that. And it's a little bit rough, as you can see right now, and then we do a lot of body working to work on the seams of the car to start to smooth it out. We cut open the areas for the hood, the trunk, and then make it a very, very smooth transition from this to the next step, which is over here.
Hey, well, why, hey, that's something, right? Hey, you're really into this comic book.
Now, yeah, really, seriously. Now, I mean, I got a quick question for you here. Mm-hmm. Obviously, the comic book thing. Right. Mm-hmm. Right. You get into that probably for the same reason John got into magic, right?
Yeah, I read too many comic books.
No, I was going to say, you guys got into the stuff with the chicks, yeah, right? Come on, you can tell me, really? You know?
Well, don't tell my wife.
Your secret is safe with us and all 5 million fans who are watching right now.
So I was only kidding, honey.
Yeah, I'm not the homewrecker guy. Yeah. that was the Batmobile.
A guy named Bolt, you saw there, Mark Rako,
right,
and his Fiberglass Freaks have the official license from DC Comics to reproduce the 1966 Batmobile, and they do it with absolute precision and perfection. But Mark, apparently, this guy was 2 years old, watching Batman on TV, and apparently then he announced, one day I'm going to build
that car,
you know? And sure enough, he did. He was 17 when he built the first one. He's actually a filmmaker also. He's used the first car that he built in a couple of fan films, and he's been very successful building this car. And he went to George Barris, who was the one who designed the original car, based on a concept car that was from Mercury, I believe. And this guy has let him see all the original specs and drawings. He's measured the original cars, and so he, with absolute precision, reproduces these things, and they're fabulous. Only 150,000 a pop.
Only 150,000.
Yeah, I'm running out to get mine tomorrow.
Yeah,
I'm
laying down one of those.
Free transportation to Logansport, Indiana. Right. Yeah. Is that right?
So we're gonna actually go back to another break here.
We were just getting started on the
Batman. We'll be right back. E. Campbell. Mm-hmm. Yeah, don't forget the E, apparently.
No.
it's a very different Ulysses Cannons out there.
Well, that, of course, just a SAG-AFTRA guy, you know? It's gotta be a certain one.
Why don't you tell us about season four coming up here?
We've got some real exciting things coming up for season four. You know, because as you mentioned, with the preponderance of these comic book movies that are coming out, this is the perfect time to be a geek. In fact, one of the shows that we just shot recently was about a golden age of geekdom. You know, I mean, basically, are we living in some, is this the promised land for the geeks and nerds in the world?
You think with all the movies coming out, like all the Marvel movies are coming, like the Avengers came out recently.
Breaking records.
Spider-Man, the guy's smart enough to work a computer and did his software.
But it all started with somebody who took pencil to paper to create these things. And, you know, then now these new people have the vision to be able to, you know, put them out. But, no, I'm real excited about where the show is going. We have, well, there's some stuff that I did in the studio. I mean, but, you know, of course you got to go out to comic book conventions and, you know, get interviews and into events and stuff like that. But something brand new that we have just started doing, I've only taped two shows like this so far, but I started using a mobile production van. So we're coming soon to a neighborhood comic book store near you.
Wow, you have a budget. I don't really have a budget.
He's getting paid? Hey, what's going on?
Not getting paid. But no, this is going to enable us to help seek some sponsorship and some underwriters.
Okay.
Because if you can lend value to somebody's store coming out there, hopefully that's worth something.
Right.
And, you know, you put out the press releases and you say, hey, we're shooting at this local store, and, you know, then the local press comes out. I mean, in fact, I had cast and crew members who were buying stuff. And I get, in fact, the fella, Jeff Weaver, who was on the show, he owns the store. Right. I kept going to him. I was like, Jeff, you see that? We're buying stuff. You see that? Look at that.
Yeah.
You
know?
But, you know, heck of a nice guy. And it's a beautiful, a very large place, you know, enough room for us to settle into. And, you know, hopefully it gets people out, gets them interested, because, you know, I'm all about helping to promote interest in these various genres. In fact, I'm almost ashamed to admit this to you guys, but one of the stated goals. One of the stated goals, I appreciate that. It's a difficult admission, but I have sort of like a little mission statement on the show as far as these are the reasons that we're doing this. And in addition to helping to create media that covers the comic book industry, I'm interested in promoting literature, science fiction literature, fantasy literature, you know, getting kids to read. Read a book. You shouldn't be up late watching this show.
Books are your friend.
That's right.
Unless you set the TiVo. We're not talking about the
books that you read when you didn't want to read the book.
Cliff Notes version.
Yeah.
See, that's how I didn't, because I never did that when I was a kid.
So the moral of the story here is, kids, read a book, but first watch this show. Watch the show, then you read a book.
But this was one of the cool things that I did, because the Nebula Awards were in the Washington
Awards.
The science fiction writers, science fiction and fantasy writers of America.
Oh, lock up your daughters.
Hey, this is a pretty cutthroat band here. You know? But they had their award ceremony in Crystal City, Virginia, back in late May. I found out about it. I said, well, you know, because they give out, one of the big awards for science fiction is called the Nebula Awards. It's a really beautiful trophy, too.
N-E-B-L-U-A. Nebula.
N-E-B-U-L-A. I can't spell. It's after midnight.
No, it wasn't a test. You're not getting graded. I was just
thank the Lord, because I would have failed miserably.
Nebula. You know, but you did all right there. You know, Nebula, I mean, it's very nebulous.
I see what you did there.
A little word jujitsu for you.
They had their awards. And big banquet, and they gave, because they give out one for the best novel, best novella, best short story, all kinds of stuff like this. Yeah. Anyway, so I went out because, again, one of my stated goals is to promote literature. And I realized, and this is my sad and sorry admission, that I had not been doing this at all. It's been mostly about the comic books and about the, you know, I mean, nothing about actual books. And so I said, you know, this isn't in line with what I'm supposed to be doing. So it was a lot of fun. I met Neil Gaiman, who is a very well-respected science fiction writer. In fact, he had just won an award for an episode of the BBC TV series Doctor Who that evening, an episode called The Doctor's Wife.
Right.
And a very entertaining woman named Jo Walton, who won the Nebula Award for Best Novel. And you know, it was a wonderful evening that I felt is going to be something that ultimately helps to bring more people to science fiction literature.
Well, Michael Crichton made a wonderful contribution with his Jurassic Park dinosaur movies. And of course, his books matched the movie. In fact, his books were better than some of the movies. So anybody who does science fiction does it well. You're encouraging children to read.
Well, what about Ray Bradbury, who just passed away with Fahrenheit 451?
Oh, right. Yeah. Wow. Right.
A classic. Right.
And then, you know, there's other science fiction writers we're going to talk about when we come right back.
Okay.
After Midnight.
After Midnight.
After Midnight, baby.
Near the end of the show, we gotta say goodbye.
I don't want to say goodbye.
I know.
Can't we have an all night party?
This is Ulysses E. Campbell from the Fantastic Forum show.
The party silly stops.
Check this show out. You saw the clips. It's a great show. Go check it out.
Right? www.fantasticforum.tv.
There you go.
And like us on Facebook. And follow us on Twitter.
And
how tweet it is.
Thank you again.
All right,
thank you
so
much. All right,
take care.
Good work.
Thank you.
I'll be on again.
Yes.
All
right.
All right, we got to move back.
All right,
shift.
Good one. I don't
want
to have to.
Ooh, 38.
Right.
Shift.
Back in frame here now.
Shift.
All right. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Welcome back.
I was only there, but I must have been off the end of the earth.
We can only hope.
Well, fantastic.
You travel that far sometimes. Actually.
I do. You know, so, it varies the distance sometimes.
Right. You know, as far away as only an hour and a half for to Tibet.
The other side.
Sometimes he crosses the border.
Yeah.
You know, island down.
Yeah.
That's if I'm living dangerously.
Jeez. Ooh. So where are you planning on going to next?
Well, next time is going to be a little longer. Going to Tibet.
But you actually are going to Tibet. Wow. I pulled Tibet out of thin air.
Well,
you actually are going to Tibet.
I actually am going to Tibet next
7 years? For 7 years?
Close to that. That's what my wife hopes.
I know.
No, I've got a good friend. We do a little trekking. We're going to, I've got to start working out because we're going to hike over a 19,000 foot pass.
Oh.
And so keep watching this show because this show will have some clips. We'll have some segments. There's another wonderful show called On the Road, and it'll be a more fully expanded version. All right, so we talked about Tibet, but some footage that has been on another show, but it's worth showing to our viewers, is when I was down in Patagonia. Rickety old bridge. Now, you've heard about Patagonia, you go trekking. Yeah. So we're going to take a look at a clip. I'm going to talk as this clip plays, because the wind was so strong that I could not do the audio. So our viewers right now are listening to me. We're here, the wind in the background there. Rickety old bridge.
That.
We made it across
yeah.
with our lives. I'm here to tell the tale. we're probably almost at the end of the clip, so I'm going to have to start doing my voiceover.
A little scary.
Yeah, it was a little scary, but I live to tell the tale down in Patagonia, which is in Chile and a little bit in Argentina.
Well, as I say, you have them there. Wow, that's beautiful.
Hey,
Jason, now, John, you know, being a magician, could you levitate across that bridge?
Only if I have the ability to fight gravity. And I haven't conquered that one. I've fallen on stage many times. In fact, my whole act has failed on stage.
Hey, speaking of your act, you got any gigs coming up that we should know about?
Sure, yeah. I'll be purchasing something called the Magic Mansion.
Okay.
It's a miracle I can make the final mortgage payment on it.
You know what, that burning wallet, it's not going to do you any good.
It's not going to do me any good.
With paying that mortgage.
Yeah. That would be a good excuse, though, if you went into the bank and said, I can't pay the mortgage this month. Look!
Well, it's a good excuse.
It's like the dog
bankers are these days. I don't even think that can get you out.
It's like, well, I did my homework.
Well, I did get one of those Discover cards. I was down next to the market, reached into somebody's pocket, and I discovered a card, so I'm okay now.
Discover card. Did they pay you to say that? If they didn't pay, they don't get mentioned on this show. All right.
Just trying to keep it real here.
I know.
Right. Yeah, we're keeping it real. The show that I do, it's based on urban life, right here in Baltimore.
You know about urban life?
Urban life. Man, let me tell you, I was born in the South, the deep South, South Baltimore.
Oh,
you
know.
And of course, living in South Baltimore means that you get to travel the whole length and breadth of the city, because there's nothing else in South Baltimore but Cherry Hill, and you just move south above that, and of course, there's the rest of the city. I've had the occasion of being a part of the film crew for AFRAM, the Stone Soul Picnic, the various ethnic festivals. Whenever there's an act in town that we want to capture and actually interview the various guests, we on Keeping It Real are there with a camera and crew, and we do some interviews.
All right, well, it is after midnight, and actually it's well after midnight. It's too far past midnight for us. We're going to have to sign off here.
That's right.
So, gentlemen, let's say goodbye to a wonderful audience here.
Maybe
read a book, you know, say no to drugs, all that. And the band.
End of the Easter Show.
All right. And thank you, gentlemen.
And our band.
All right, very good. Well, thank you very much, and on behalf of Steve and John and Mr. Squire, thank you very much for watching.
After midnight!
That was the first episode of mine here, and hope you liked. If you want to get in touch with me, you can do it one of two ways. You can either friend me on Facebook, it's Nick McGuire. Reach me on Twitter, Miggity Mick, it's MIGIDIMICK. And also my email address, McGuire.Mick@gmail.com. And I say you again.
Well, this wouldn't be an adventure if we didn't have some kind of wildlife on the show. These look like llamas, but they're not. They're actually close cousins to the llama. As you can see, we're in, unfortunately, kind of a burned out area. But these folks seem to be a little, not necessarily on the friendly side, but at least they're not afraid of me. They see some green grass, they're a little hungry. So that's what they're doing. So these are not llamas, but they are close cousins.
Off the bloody chain. I mean, Halle, it was good. Bloody good. I loved it, and I love everybody you talking about. They was the Do you hear me? Do you hear me? Get that Beyonce. Put a ring on it.